हम आज के विशेष प्रबंध इस कार्यक्रम का हमारा जाने माने कन्नड़ा राइटर पोएट प्रोफेसर एच एस शिवप्रकाश जी को सुनने वाले हैं। आप सब जानते हैं प्रोफेसर एच एस शिवप्रकाश जी, बेसिकली एन एम ए इन इंग्लिश लिटरेचर फ्रॉम बैंगलोर यूनिवर्सिटी, बॉर्न एंड ब्रॉट अप इन बैंगलोर, रिनाउंड कन्नड़ा प्ले राइटर एंड ए पोएट, एंड हिज प्लेस एंड मेनी आर्टिकल्स एंड बुक्स हैव बीन ट्रांसलेटेड इनटू सेवरल लैंग्वेजेस ऑफ इंडिया, हिंदी, मलयालम, मराठी, तमिल एंड तेलुगु, एज वेल एज ही ऑल्सो हेड्स अ चेयर कॉल्ड कल्चरल सेंटर एट बर्लिन, विच इज ऑल्सो नोन एज टागोर सेंटर, एंड इज द करेंटली इज द डायरेक्टर. It is run by the Council for Cultural Relations, Government of India. And Professor H.S. Shivaprakash ji is also known for his very well written articles in our Kannada publications. As we all know, his contribution to Bhakti movements is also not a small one. He has done a lot of work on Bhakti movement of Karnataka, and he is currently serving as a professor in the Jawaharlal Nehru University in the Department of Arts, School of Arts and Culture. I would request Professor Shivaprakash ji to present his special lecture or keynote address on the occasion.
I am friends of the dais and friends in the auditorium. I don't make this mistake often. I hardly speak in English in front of my Kannada audiences, because I give the word to Purushottam Agrawal ji, but to the other Purushottam, that I'll speak in a way that's intelligible to you. So I'm making this mistake, so I beg you to forgive me for this mistake. It's very difficult to speak about Bhakti movement after listening to a speech on the same subject by an eminent authority like my friend Professor Purushottam Agrawal ji. In the last few years, I've had several occasions to listen to him on the theme of bhakti. Every time I listen to him, he discovers something new. Every one of his speeches and presentations, bhakti, is an eye-opener, and in fact, he has left very little for me to speak on this occasion. But of course, there are several authorities who are going to speak at Kanakadasa, like my friend Kata Chikanda, whom I call Kyata Chikanda. He's a famous writer, also a very good short story writer. He has a play at Kanakadasa, a very good play. And my friends from Karnataka, my guru, in a way, Professor Sidramaya, who taught me how to read ancient Kannada poetry. When I passed out of my MA, I hardly could read pre-modern Kannada. He's the one who initiated me into reading ancient Kannada poetry. He's himself an eminent poet. So though he's now today is dressed more like a politician, he's a poet. So he's here, and my former colleague and neighbor Chamanlalji is here, and Subodh Kesari, the eminent poet, is here, and all of you. And I may thought there were some of my friends maybe hidden in the darkness over there. So I was just thinking what I can add to the some of the important statements that Purushottam ji has made on the bhakti movements. He first raised the question, can bhakti traditions or whatever can be called movements at all? I'll return to this question. This is a very important question, and it's important that we resolve this so that we are able to understand the name and nature of bhakti. I'm reminded of a question which bothered Tagore at some point of time. Tagore hardly ever glorified the word nationalism, but Tagore was always trying to understand what constitutes the unity of Indian cultures. And he said, if you look at great eminent people who talk about the unities of Indian culture, unity in diversity, somebody says Vedanta constitutes the unity of Indian culture. Somebody says Hinduism constitutes the unity of Indian culture. Somebody says everything is made of Sanskrit. But Tagore says no. The unity of Indian culture, and some people say the unity of Indian culture is constituted by the Ramayana or the Mahabharata. Though there are many communities in this country who have never heard of the Ramayana or the Mahabharata, for example, many tribes in the Northeast. Of course, they are very important epics, there are different versions of it, but there are also communities in India which have nothing to do with the Ramayana or the Mahabharata. So what constitutes the unity of Indian culture? So Tagore, the answer that he came up with was this, that the unity of Indian culture is constituted by our bhakti and folk and tribal traditions. Today, Hinduism has not been able to hold us together. The more we try to erect it as the mark of unity, the more divided we find the society. Today, globalization has not been able to keep people together. The more globalized we become, the more apart we are pulled. Science and technology has not been able to keep people together. But for well over a millennium, from 6th century of the common era, right up to the advent of colonialism, even after, our bhakti traditions held our Indian cultures together. Is this a movement or not? If you think that bhakti movements are movements like Naxalite movement or Samada movement, progressive movement, this movement, that movement, they're not movements in that sense, of course. But they really injected dynamism, movement, into an otherwise static Indian culture. Karl Marx, when he theorized about pre-modern India, he said India was part of what he calls Oriental mode of production, one of those static societies. Colonialism came as a deliverance. But Karl Marx didn't know enough of pre-modern Indian history. Poor fellow has read about India only through colonial historians. It was bhakti traditions these days, because I want to avoid this word movement, though I'm aware that it brought about a great movement, because the word movement has become loaded. Look at the way it moves. It starts, there is a Sanskrit epic, later day Sanskrit epic, written in the early part of the second millennium, Padma Purana, which says that Bhakti is a beautiful girl born in Dravida Desha in the south, and she grew up in Maharashtra, attained maturity in Gujarat. Then what happened to her later? Because that's where this text stops. The story is much longer. There were debates about whether bhakti is native to India or came from outside. In Hindi, this debate went on. But to the best of my knowledge, it began in the south in Tamil Nadu. And then from Tamil Nadu, it fans out to the neighboring region of Karnataka, parallelly to Andhra. At the same time, another trajectory goes eastwards to Orissa, to Bengal, then from Karnataka to Maharashtra, from Maharashtra to Gujarat and Rajasthan, and right from the bank of the Kaveri, which is described evocatively in Tamil bhakti poetry, up to the banks of the Jhelum, where lived the greatest Kashmiri poet, lulled. Bhakti overwhelms the whole of India and transforms the cultural landscape of the country. If you look at the several descriptions of Bhakti movement in the available literature, we find two opposite versions. Some people say Bhakti was anti-Sanskritic. This statement is based on profound ignorance, because some of the greatest works of Sanskrit poetry, which can compete with the poetry of even greats like Kalidasa, were written by Sanskrit Bhakti poets. Like Kulashekara Adwar from Tamil Nadu, who was also a Tamil poet. He was Nadwar. His Mukundamala is one of the most heart-melting, if I can use that word in English, expressions of Bhakti in Sanskrit. At Kashmir, the great philosopher Acharya Utpaladeva, who was one of the teachers of Acharya Abhinav Gupta, wrote a remarkable work of poetry which has been neglected by Bhakti scholars. We talk about it, Shivastotravali. And Jayadeva's Gita Govindam is also, it wouldn't have come into being but for Bhakti traditions, and it's one of the greatest contributions to Sanskrit poetry. For the first time, sound becomes meaning in Sanskrit poetry. So Jayadeva's Sanskrit is different from the Sanskrit of Kalidasa or Bhasa, whoever. So Bhakti traditions enrich Sanskrit also. And then some people say it's anti-Vedic. A lot of our leftist and Dalit friends have been saying this. It's not altogether false. To some extent this is right. But was this that kind of anti-Brahminical or anti-Vedic movement? If you come to think of it, Bhakti saints not only attacked Brahmins, they also attacked Jains, Tantrics, and some of them who took the Nirguna form of Bhakti attacked temple going. I can give you an extreme example from Kannada. Ambigara Chaudhaya the ferryman, says in one of his poems, Kattida lingava bittu bettada lingakke hoge hotte yariyage namisoda kandane Nimma yadapadada bettadu amindadalli adhyavada muddu mukakke pata 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 huri yadda Ambigara Chaudhaya. If you see a man who abandons the linga and the body and goes and bends down before a linga on the mount, on the hill, take out your left sandal, dip it in shit and hit on his face 78 times non-stop, he says. So it's not just anti-Brahminism. And on the one hand, our Bhakti poet says, Vedas have nothing to do with it. Akkamahadevi says, Vedangadiga Vedyadu, he cannot be known by the Vedas. Shastrangadiga Sadhyadu, is impossible for Shastras. Agamangadiga Agambyadu, Agamas cannot even guess him. At the same time, Mahadeva, Mahadeva, the Shruti Saride. It's also the essence of the Vedas. It's against the Vedas. So what are these contradictory, conflicting aspects of Bhakti? Acharya Utpaladeva, in one of the shlokas of Shivastotravali, says, Vedagama viruddhaya, Vedagama vidayine, Vedagama Satapraya Guhyaya Swamide Namaha. You are both for Vedas, you are against the Vedas, you are pervaded by Vedas, you are impenetrable. Some people say Bhakti movements were anti-worldly. Some people say they distracted Indians from their worldly life. Some people say there were materialist movements. Even these contradictory things are said. Acharya Utpaladeva recognizes this also. Sangiraika nimittaya samsareika nimittaya samsareika virodhine namas samsara rupaya this samsaraya shambhavi. You are both for samsara, you are against samsara. You are the embodiment of samsara, you are beyond samsara. You are the form of samsara and you are not samsara. So bhakti is that phenomenon which constitutes, comprehends all aspects of Indian spiritual experience, which does not exclude the experience of the world. There are some people today, like who were fattened on the huge fellowships by foreign universities, like Balagangadhara, who come and tell us, No, bhakti saints were not against caste system. It was all fine with them because they just said, to be a bhakta, it belong to any caste. And they repeated what Shankaracharya said. They had nothing new to say. So people like Balagangadhara neither know what Shankaracharya said, nor do they know what bhakti people say. You see, bhakti was not the same. It was the same. There are lots of continuities. But there were lots of innovations. That's why every region where bhakti went created a new form of poetry, a new form of theatre, a new form of music. In some places like Nathdwara in the Rajasthan, visual arts, paintings. In Tamil Nadu, it gave a film to temple architecture. All kinds of a full efflorescence of arts according to the place and time. Because bhakti, like Sufism, had a lot of continuities at the same time and adapted to the situation. Sufis say that to be a good communicator, one should know zaman, makan, wakan. Zaman is the time when you are speaking. We need to understand, why do we need to revisit bhakti now? Because bhakti is now in danger. Bhakti is being hijacked. Our saint said, bhakti yambudu torum balaba. Bhakti has become the means of profit. So that's why, zaman, bakan, situation, audience, which audience we are speaking to. So bhakti saints went on changing the modes of expression. They were not stylists, but they could play between and create so many styles. So bhakti constitutes both the unity and diversities of Indian culture, and therefore it has to be remembered today when bhakti has become a means of cheating and making profit. Having said this, Purushottamji said we need to have comparative research, comparative understanding of our bhakti traditions. These days I prefer to call them bhakti currents or bhakti streams, currents and cross currents of bhaktis, because that makes it sounds very dynamic when we characterize it that way. So we need to have this. But unfortunately, this cannot be done by any individual, because bhakti was written not just in Sanskrit, not just in the mainstream languages of India. It was also written in the tribal languages of India. For example, Bhils of Gujarat, who created their own Ramayana Mahabharata, they declare that the Mahabharata is a Kabirpanti Mahabharata. So they direct this, there's no image of Rama, they just light up a lamp which is identified with the cosmic spirit. So none of us know so many languages. In fact, our tragedy in the age of globalization, and the age of globalization is also the globe of Englishization, that we are developing greater and greater amnesia about our own languages. We are forgetting our own languages. And our languages were made possible. Our languages attain glory because of bhakti poets. And we are forgetting our languages. And one of the means of remembering our languages is to remember our bhakti poets. Look at any major Indian language. The language of those, the living language of those literatures was created by bhakti poets. Sheldon Pollack, talking about South Asian literary history, says that bhakti was the second revolution. The first revolution happened during the Sanskrit period and later during the vernacular revolution that he locates around the beginning of the second millennium, but it's not true because the literature that came before bhakti, for example, languages like Kannada and Telugu, was only imitative of Sanskrit. But bhakti emerged out of local literary usages which have not been documented. This was the people's tradition. So what we have, the Sanskrit dependent traditions in our languages, I call them Tatsama and Tadbhava traditions, but not native traditions. Native traditions were actually bhakti traditions. Marathi was a language created by Namdev and Tukaram. Kannada is a language created by or Shaiva and Vaishnava and bhakti poets and also Sufi Tattvapadakaras. And Hindi is a language created by Tulsi and Kabir. So it is our bhakti poets who have created our languages. So in order to understand our languages, in order to understand the dynamism, the potential of our languages, it's important for us to revisit bhakti and look at it from a comparative perspective. But one individual cannot do it. It has to be a collaborative effort because none of us know all those languages. And it's important for us to have many such, you know, collaborative events to start gathering the diverse, innumerable strands of bhakti. So just to conclude, I said the conflicting things said about bhakti, conservative, revolutionary, reformatory. There are some people from some of my JD colleagues, eminent historians, like Champak Lakshmi, who have argued, Marxist historians have argued that bhakti gave a fillip to Brahminism. Bhakti was an agent of Brahminism. And some American scholars like Michael Blake, who worked on the Kannada Shunya Sampada traditions, have come to the same conclusion. And some people say that bhakti was a revolution. For example, in the Nordic scholar has written a book on the so-called Virashiva movement of Karnataka. He calls it the revolution of mystics. Some scholars who are of sociological background, like Hiremalu Rishwarad, say that it was bhakti movements were Protestant movements for India, because there was Protestant movement in Europe, and because there was a Catholic church, so there must be a Protestant movement in India. Because there was a revolution, Renaissance in Europe, we should have Renaissance here as well. Because there was modernism there, we should have modernism. They have postmodernism there, we should have postmodernism. Tomorrow, if they have postmodernism there, we want to have postmodernism. Now, what are we trying to do? We are trying to, it's like an anthropologist going to meet, to try to understand and inform it from a culture he knows nothing about. We are in such a, because there is a hiatus created between us and pre-colonial traditions because of the trauma of colonialism. Instead of imposing the colonial and post-colonial concepts on pre-modern cultural phenomena, I think we should listen to what those texts are saying. Listen carefully to what they're saying. Maybe they have a lot to tell us than we think we know. When you speak to an elderly person of an ancient tradition, don't try to read your meanings into him. Listen to him carefully. He may have things to tell you. He may have some important warnings to give you, some important pieces of advice to give you, which you, because of the limited experience of modernity, the postmodernity, which has lasted hardly 300, 400 years. Remember, even the ancient Egyptian civilization lasted for nearly 700 years. We don't know. So the cumulative, collective wisdom of bhakti saints, who learn from each other, it's not that they are unaware of each other. When Namdev, after the death of Sant Gnaneshwar, went northwards, he started hating Maharashtra because the Marathi people had caused the death of a great saint like his guru Gnandev. He goes to Punjab. In Punjab, he starts writing in Punjabi. And because of Namdev's influence, later Sikhism is born. And Sikhism is perhaps the only religion in the world where the anthology of poetry, Guru Granth Sahib, becomes the scripture. And so many innovations. Even the mechanical genre of poetry, like Sahasranama, we have Shiva Sahasranama, this has that Sahasranama in India. Even this can become a means of great poetry in the hands of bhakti poets is demonstrated by Guru Gobind Singh's Japo Sahib. The way he brings together Sanskrit, Arabic, Persian, Rajasthani, Punjabi, Namo Raja Raja, Namo Teja Teja, Namo Shahin Shah Shaha, Namo Ranka Ranka, the free play of all these languages, it creates a remarkable effect. So, bhakti traditions have effected innumerable transformations, innovations in Indian culture, and the like of it, in spite of all the gains and achievements of our periods of modernity and modernism and contemporary literature, I still feel we have not been able to match the achievement of our bhakti poets. I write poetry in my language, but I always think I am not even a small drop in the ocean of the poetry of Akka Mahadevi. Because the achievement in poetry, the maturity of their voice is so overpowering, we feel humbled. So it's important for all cultures in the world, in the globalizing world, countries of the South, third world countries, to arrive at what the Nigerian poet playwright Ulashenka called cultural self-apprehension. And India, the means of a cultural self-apprehension is to understand and explore and learn lessons from our variegated Bhakti traditions, which constitute both the unity and diversity of Indian culture, as was observed by Rabindranath Tagore. I'm very happy that the department of the new Kannada chair of JNU, which has been much more active than the many old chairs of JNU, and this Kanaka Study Center, headed by the former head of Kannada Culture Department, Mr. Chikanna. Kannada Culture Department is one of the most cultured departments of government departments in India, because the amount of contributions they made to culture, thanks to people like Chikanna, is, though I don't like very fond of cultural institutions, I mean the government institutions very much, I have this secret admiration for Kannada Culture Department, looking at the range of things that they have done. And I'm happy that they have got people together here for this seminar, where Kanakadasa is being placed and understood in the context of Indian tradition, Indian Bhakti traditions, because none of our Bhakti poets can be understood without knowledge of the whole of Indian Bhakti traditions, which is still beyond our reach, but we are still making small beginnings. So with these words, I stop here, and thanks everyone.